1971. The Marin Children's Chorus will celebrate the equinox as they present birdsong, music and melodies to welcome spring. The concert features over 90 singers, aged 6 to 14, on Saturday, March 24th at 3:30 p.m. at the First Presbyterian Church, 72 Kensington Road in San Anselmo. Tickets are $12. Call 415-898-3331 or go to www.marinechorus.org for more information. The community calendar is produced by members of the KPFA Apprenticeship Program. Send your listings at least 3 weeks in advance to KPFA Box 51, 1929 Martin Luther King Jr. Way in Berkeley, California, 94704, or fax them to 510-848-3812 or email us at calendar@kpfa.org. Attention, the community calendar. Tell us if your event is wheelchair accessible. To hear this calendar again, call 510-848-6767 extension 621. The calendar is also online at kpfa.org.
You're listening to KPFA, KPFB in Berkeley, or KFCF in Fresno, or on the web at kpfa.org. It's 7 p.m. Up next is Full Circle. Stay tuned.
From the circle, yes, we rotate. Full circle, yes, we rotate. 360 degrees, ha ha. 360 degrees, ha ha. 306, 306, 360 degrees, ha ha.
Welcome to Full Circle, your cultural affairs radio magazine. This week, we examine incarceration and its effects on our community.
On tonight's show, we hear a commentary from Momia Abu-Jamal.
We will learn about the recent death row execution of Joseph Nichols.
Speak with the executive director of Survivors International, a group that provides support to victims of torture.
We will visit the Prisoners Literature Project in Berkeley.
Hear about a new jazz album inspired by prison spirituals.
And listen to a commentary on prisons and education.
We're your hosts, Rod Akil
and Johannes Bra. Stay tuned.
Can you imagine sitting in a prison cell waiting to die? In this next commentary, death row journalist Momia Abu-Jamal describes the horror of his experience while highlighting a few of the political, economic, and racial concerns surrounding America's death row.
Imagine living, eating, sleeping, relieving oneself, daydreaming, weeping, but mostly waiting in the room the size of your bathroom. Now imagine doing all those things, but mostly waiting for the rest of your life. Imagine waiting, waiting, waiting to die. I don't have to imagine. I live in one of those rooms, like about 3,000 other men and women in 38 states across the United States. It's called death row. I call it hell. Welcome to hell. Each of the states which have death rows have a different system for their execution cases, varying from the relatively open to the severely restrictive. Some states, like California and Texas, allow their execution cases work, education, and/or religious service opportunities for out-of-cell time up to 8 hours a day. Pennsylvania locks its execution cases down 23 hours a day, 5 days a week, 24 hours the other 2 days. At the risk of quoting Mephistopheles, I repeat, welcome to hell. A hell erected and maintained by human governments and blessed by black robe judges. A hell which allows you to see your loved ones, but not to touch them. A hell situated in America's boondocks, hundreds of miles away from most families. A white rural hell where most of the cage captives are black and urban. It is the American way of death. Contrary to what one might suppose, this hell is the easiest one to enter in a generally hellish criminal justice system. Why? Because unlike any other case, those deemed potential capital cases are severely restricted during the jury selection phase, as any juror who admits opposition to the death penalty is immediately and automatically removed, leaving only those who are fervent death penalty supporters in the pool of eligible jurors. When it is argued that to exclude those who oppose death and to include only those who supported death was fundamentally unfair, as the latter were more conviction-prone, the United States Supreme Court, in a case titled Lockhart versus McCree, said such a claim was of no constitutional significance. Once upon a time, politicians promised jobs and benefits to constituents, like a chicken in every pot to get elected. It was a surefire vote-getter. No longer. Today, the lowest-level politico up to the president use another surefire gimmick to guarantee victory. Death. Promise death, and the election is yours. Guaranteed. Vraiment. A vote for hell in the land of liberty, with its over 1 million prisoners, is the ticket to victory. From death row, this is Mumia Abu Jamal.
Harris County, Texas, has the highest rate of death penalty sentences and execution in the United States. These death penalty sentences are further marked by many race and class inequalities.
Joseph Nichols was executed by the state of Texas on March 7th. His case is one of many that reflects the injustices of American capital punishment. Rose Katapchi talked with those who followed the case closely, among them his mother, Lee Greenwood. Up next, she brings us more on the case.
In 1980, Claude Schaefer, an employee of a delicatessen, was killed by a single shot. In 1995, Willie Williams was executed for his murder. Joseph Nichols died 2 weeks ago on March 7th. He was executed in Harris County, Texas, for a crime he did not commit and that the previous defendant, Willie Williams, had already been executed for. I spoke with two men familiar with the Nichols case, as well as Joseph's mother, Lee Greenwood, trying to sort out the details and figure out what can be done now. Jim Marcus is a professor at the Texas School of Law, where he supervises students working on death penalty cases. Joseph Nichols' case stood out to him for a number of reasons.
Two people were sentenced to death for firing the same bullet. The juries that sentenced the two people to death were each led to believe that the defendant in their case was the trigger man. He had a lawyer who was eventually disbarred. He kept missing the deadline to file the appellate brief, and they eventually threw him in jail, and he wrote the appeal brief from a jail cell. Just not the sort of thing that anybody who could afford to hire good lawyers would put up with. Always, at least a few students each semester are aspiring prosecutors. Once they see what's happening in these cases, they're really shocked because there is an assumption that there is a certain level of fairness and competency that is inherent in these cases that's just simply lacking.
Here he talks about Houston justice and what he's witnessed personally.
Having really worked full-time in Texas on capital post-conviction cases since 1993, what I've seen is that the people that get the worst lawyers get the death penalty. Depends on jurisdiction. There's 254 counties in Texas, but one county alone, which is Harris County, Houston, accounts for one-third of all the death sentences. The same crime that might be a capital crime in Houston, for example, may not be a capital crime in Fort Worth. The individual prosecutors, the elected district attorneys, have a tremendous amount of discretion. Judges here in Texas are elected. State courts are really loath to overturn cases to the point where it is still to this day the law in Texas that your lawyers are not necessarily ineffective, even if they sleep through your capital trial.
Here's Andrew Lebetkin, a documentary filmmaker familiar with the Nichols case.
I think if you can illustrate the inadequacies, the gross inadequacies of the system, there isn't anyone who thinks this is fair. No one could claim two people fired the same bullet. we have to have a moratorium until we can straighten out the system. There has to be some kind of accountability for a judge that allows this kind of attorney to handle a man's case when his life is on the line. If you were to contact the district attorney today, what he'd say is, well, all we did was do our best to do our jobs, and it's been through our court system, the federal court system, and they found that there was no problem with it. At that point, there's really not much of a conversation left.
Joseph Nichols' mother spoke with me a week after her son's death at the hands of the government. She shares her experience as a mother and talks about her continuing fight against the death penalty.
You know, they printed, newspaper printed, that he spoke obscenities as he was being murdered, but they neglected to say what happened to him prior to his execution. He had been subjected to having his clothes cut off his body in Livingston at the prison. He was driven from Livingston to Huntsville to the death house with nothing but boxer shorts and chains. No shoes, no socks, no shirt, no pants. I guess they call it humane. We were able to visit with him until 12 noon on Wednesday. Then we were escorted off the premises of the prison, and then we drove from Livingston to Huntsville, where we were able to speak with him by phone from 3 until 5 p.m. So when we saw him again, he was stretched out on a gurney getting ready to be executed. I think the last time I touched my son was in 1990, maybe. When I touched him again, he was dead. It's very hard. You have no idea. There are not words to explain how hard it is. I have to keep a promise that I made to Joseph. He knew that it was a great possibility living in the state of Texas that he would be executed, even though he had not killed anyone. But he asked me, if he meant the death machine, would I just promise that he would be a part of seeing that it was stopped? I will do all that I can to do that, which means I will still attend meetings, I will still go to conferences, I will still fight to abolish the death penalty. I owe him that. I owe my great-grandson that's coming up that's only 16 years old, I owe him that. I owe every other little black, brown, or poor white boy the same thing.
How does she respond to the injustice inherent to the justice system, proven here by the outcome in her son's case?
It's ludicrous. If lay people, and I be of that group, can see the wrong in it, you know, why didn't the Texas Court of Criminal Appeals, why didn't the Fifth Circuit, why didn't the U.S. Supreme Court do something about it? You have to finally come to the realization that they don't care. If we, as a family, were multimillionaires or just millionaires, my son would not be dead today. Just as all, my son would never have ever gone to trial. Or if he did, he would have gotten maybe probation or something and would have been out living a life outside of bars. Now, he lived a life inside. He helped a lot of people along the way. As long as they could not and they did not imprison his mind, sure, they restricted his movements. But life is more than just movement.
I asked Lee what she felt people could do to ensure that the justice system operates as fairly as possible.
For one thing, you can encourage people to look very closely at the people that they elect, can look at the issues that are in your city and state government, look at the bills and things that you vote for. What's on the surface is not what's underneath. Say, for instance, the bill that they just passed that they're trying to get through both the House and the Senate here in Texas, Jessica's Law. On the surface, that's all nice and fuzzy, and it sounds like, you know, that would be good. There needs to be something done about sex offenders. But is it just to further the death penalty? Of course it is. Of course it is. If you have a day off, go sit down in the courts and see what happens on the opposite side of the poverty line. Go sit down there and listen. You'll hear and see some scary things. in the name of law.
Thank you to Professor Jim Marcus, Andrew Lubetkin, and Lee Greenwood. For Full Circle, this is Rose Kitabshi.
I Shall Be Released by Bob Dylan. Welcome back to Full Circle here on KPFA 94.1 FM. We're your hosts, Rod Akil.
And Johannes Durand.
We hear a lot about Guantanamo, Abu Ghraib, and many other hidden torture chambers where countless people have lost their lives or were maimed. People have suffered and continue to suffer from these experiences.
Under various pretexts, many governments have used all sorts of techniques to subdue and crush the spirit of individuals. What happens to those who survive torture? If they find their way here to the Bay Area, there are some services that help them integrate into society and become hopeful. Recently, I had the opportunity to speak with Dr. Uwe Jacobs, Executive Director of Survivors International, based in San Francisco.
Could you tell us a little bit about yourself and organization.
I'm the director, as you said, of Survivors International, which is a nonprofit organization that helps survivors of torture from around the world. Since we have been established in the late 80s, we have served about, or more than at this point, 2,000 survivors of torture from 96 different countries at last count. What we primarily do is we offer assistance with resettling people who have fled from torture in various ways. We provide psychological, psychiatric treatment. We provide medical legal assistance with asylum claims. We provide case management. We provide training and education about issues of torture within the professional communities, and do ensure that various activities that help to bring comfort, healing, practical solutions, and so on to survivors who have resettled in the Bay Area.
How do you select your clients, and how do they know that you exist to help them?
Many clients get referred to Survivors International through other agencies, lawyers, hospitals, because many survivors come here as asylum seekers. Organizations that help them in their immigration matters often refer them. So attorneys who help them get asylum, or other community-based organizations that work with immigrants, generally speaking.
Okay, how long does the program last?
There is no set time or no specific program for everybody. We sometimes provide some assistance that will last maybe a few months, until, for example, a person has gotten asylum and is ready to get a job and move on with their life. Sometimes we see people over many, many years. You know, I have had some clients who have been with us getting various kinds of services for more than 10 years. And so everything in between, you know, there's people who come and engage in a sort of a long-term kind of work on healing from trauma, and they see, say, a psychotherapist for a long time. Other people are more engaged on a short-term basis, and they get more medicines and or case management, and it doesn't last that long. And some people come to groups that may last for a specific amount of time or that go on forever, such as, for instance, groups that we help organize and run and sponsor for victims of domestic violence from other countries, or group for Cambodian women that has existed for a long time. So there are these various activities that people get involved in, and it depends to some degree a lot on where people are coming from, you know.
Is it your experience that this person has recovered fully from all that experience that he has gone through or she has gone through?
It varies a great deal, like with everything else. I would say that when you talk about somebody being tortured for a long time, such as being incarcerated for a number of years and undergoing torture, it really is not possible to get back to the same state. You know, a person really changes with that kind of an experience, and people can have symptoms related to the torture they've experienced for a lifetime, and that's often the case. It may be a typical situation is that somebody covers and feels better. Most of the time people will tell you that they have changed. It's not as though this can be cured, like you recover from a flu or for some, you know, this is a life-changing experience for people.
Could you share with our listeners a case that would have highlighted your program?
Sitting here talking to you, and I'm very aware of where you come from and the work that you have done in your part of the world, the Horn of Africa, reminds me of the fact that the first person that I ever worked with about 12 years ago with Survivors International was somebody from Ethiopia who had been locked up for years and tortured in very bad ways. A lot of it was sexual torture. And the things that she had to go through were really quite unimaginable. And I felt that I had really no idea whether she could ever recover, as you put it, from what she had gone through. It was extremely difficult for her. And by the time it ended, the therapeutic relationship that I had had with her, because she moved, I really was not sure whether it was successful at all. And in fact, I thought that maybe this is something that we just have to live with, that we can offer comfort, but it doesn't necessarily mean that somebody can really recover. And however, years later, I through an intermediary, I got the message that she had told this person that it had helped her very much, that she was doing very much better, that she had found a partner and gotten married, and that the work that she had done in therapy was extremely helpful to her. And that's a nice thing that, you know, sometimes happens. Often you don't know. Sometimes we do know, of course. We have obvious successes in the way that people recover. Sometimes it's not so clear. And in working with torture, uncertainty and despair are big factors, and you have to be prepared to deal with that.
You say you have about 2,000 or more than 2,000 that you have helped so far. Is there any follow-up system that you have so that in case they need more attention, you would give them?
Yes, we have a formal follow-up system so that we check in with everybody at least every 6 months and interview them and go through a structured set of questions. Apart from just talking to them, of course, but to make sure that we have an idea as to how they are doing in various areas of their lives and whether there is anything else that they need at this point. And people have a need and aren't even clear that we might be able to help them with that particular problem. First of all, let me say that we depend on a network of psychiatric and psychological clinicians that we have throughout the Bay Area who work for either no compensation at all or for very little compensation with the survivors of torture in their offices, or some of them come here to our office to do some of the work. And so we divide up the work amongst a community of people who help us out, right? And some people see more patients, some people see fewer, depending on what people can do. And depending on where people live, try to have some kind of a match. So it can be challenging, though, at times. So that's first in terms of how it sort of works in practice. And people will offer whatever their specialties are.
Final word?
Well, the final word is perhaps that I'm grateful you're helping us put out the word that people should think about the issue of torture, not just in terms of the way it is currently talked about with the United States government torturing people in Guantanamo Bay and places like that, but the everyday torture that happens all over the world and the people who have to run away and leave their home to come here, and they need help. And, you know, we need other people's help to do that. So I would encourage people to learn more about it, learn more about what we do. The website is www.survivorsintl.org. Or if you have a search engine, you can type in Survivors International Torture or something of the sort, and, you know, you will find us. So thanks very much for putting out the word.
Thank you, Dr. Joachim.
For Full Circle, I am Johannes Drar. Thank you and good night.
dollars is spent each year building and maintaining prisons. Yet very little of this money goes towards rehabilitation services for prisoners. Instead, there's been a drastic reduction in the number of prison programs that focus on education, recreation, and the arts. Increasingly, prisoners must look beyond the prison walls for something as simple as a good book to read. One group that prisoners turn to is the Prisoners Literature Project. Up next, Jin Lei pays the group a visit.
On a Sunday afternoon, I head over to the Grassroots House in Berkeley to meet up with volunteers from the Prisoners Literature Project. I find a group of people gathered in a small room filled floor to ceiling with books. They're talking, opening letters from prisoners, and packing up books to send throughout the country. Emily Cohen, who's worked with the project for 3 years, sits down with me to talk about how and why the project got started.
It started in Bound Together Books on Haight Street, and it basically started out of the need of some of the people working there wanted to send books to their friend in prison. And you can't just send books directly. You have to send it through, like, in a bookstore, a publisher, or something like that, an approved vendor. So they started a project based in Bound Together. And it just grew from there. It's been in people's, like, basements before. It was in San Francisco, moved across the Bay a couple times, and now it's in Berkeley.
In the past few years, funding for educational and recreational programs within prisons has been cut drastically. If prisoners want to stay informed and keep educating themselves, they have to turn to resources outside of the prison walls. This is reflected in the large numbers of letters that is sent to the project each month.
We're getting definitely over 1,000 letters every month, and it's been just growing definitely in the last 3 years that I've been here. And I think it's because it spreads by word of mouth, and then also we're in a resource guide, and also just because of the growing need for prisoners wanting literature and wanting to educate themselves and having like a diminishing access to those resources. We're about 4 months behind, which is like the farthest we've been behind in a while or since I've been here.
People read for a number of different reasons. We read to learn, to keep informed, and sometimes just to escape into fictional worlds. I'm curious what kind of materials prisoners request from the project and what their requests reflect about conditions within prisons.
Dictionaries are definitely like number one request. There's a lot of people in prison who have a really low level of just education or literacy. They want to know what words mean, and they want to know how to spell words. And so dictionaries, there's a lot of English-Spanish dictionaries. And then any kind of like educational resource or reference books, those are the most in demand or the most requested. But we also send anything you can think of, really.
Later in the day, I meet up with Gina Shepherd, another volunteer who's been working with the project for a number of years. Given that the information that goes in and out of prisons is so regulated, I ask her if the project often experiences censorship as far as materials not getting through to prisoners because of content or for other reasons.
The guards are like gods. They can do whatever they want, and they do whatever they want. For example, they have these completely arbitrary rules, like some prisons will say no martial arts. Some will say no chemistry books because they're afraid that, you know, they're going to learn something to blow up the prison. I mean, all of it's absurd. Or no nudity. And that's very difficult because we do send out a lot of art books. And if you've looked at an art book, of course, there's tons of nudity in it. It breaks my heart to have to rip out pages of books, or for a lot of prisons, we can't send hard covers, so I have to cut off the covers. That kills me for someone who loves books. Oh, and then they'll just arbitrarily just send the books back. For no reason that we can fathom.
Despite the arbitrary regulations, the censorship of materials, and the many weeks it takes the Prisoners Literature Project to meet requests, many books are getting through to prisoners. In turn, prisoners are using what they receive to expand their world and build community within prison walls. One example of this is how books are circulated among prisoners. Gina tells me about a prisoner in Nevada who's even started his own book group.
He's been in solitary for a long time, and he has a book group of all men in solitary. And what they do, because they can't meet, is they get a book, and also this prison only allows new books. And not only new books, but you have to go through all this rigmarole. They tell you what they want. You pick out the books. You send them a letter. They have to get it approved. They send you back a letter. So it takes months before they get a book. So they get a book, and then he will write an essay on the book, pass the book on to the next person with the essay, and so it goes around their circle. That's how they have a book group, writing essays. And that just impresses me so much. How many people out here in the real world will take that much effort with a book?
The story Gina shares with me reflects the importance of books and education to many prisoners. There are people who argue that these things are privileges, not basic rights. That as long as prisoners are getting food, water, and exercise, they have no cause to complain. I asked Gina how she responds to this argument.
I think that attitude is completely wrong, and you just have to think for yourself. How would you like to be locked up in a solitary with nothing to read? And personally, I would go crazy in one day. And I do get letters from people who say, thank you, you saved me from going insane. Think of yourself, you know, the books that have changed your life, books that have really made a difference to you.
Gina leaves me with a number of letters sent to the Prisoner's Literature Project. One letter reads,
dear friends, I'm writing to you in this time in the hope that I might receive a book or two from your kind and enlightened group. I just heard of your group, and I think that it's a wonderful thing what you are doing, for ignorance is the root of all evil. I would like to receive books on any of the following subjects: the government, anarchism, world history, U.S. history, or any classics, or any other type of educational materials that you might have on hand. I would like to note in closing that when I came to prison 16 years ago, I could not read or write. In this time, I have educated myself and have read over 300 books, so anything that you can send to me, I shall put to good use. Thanking you in advance, Charles R. Woods.
This letter and others like it reflect both appreciation for the work of the Prisoner's Literature Project and the stark fact that the project fills a void in many prisoners' lives. While the simple gesture of sending someone a book seems small in the face of this country's prison crisis, is actually very important. The work of the Prisoner's Literature Project and other prison book groups around the country ensures that information and books are getting to prisoners, despite the government's attempt to limit these resources through lack of funding and a prison policy fixed on warehousing people rather than rehabilitation or social transformation. If you're interested in finding out more about the project, visit their website at www.prisonersliteratureproject.com. They have work meetings on Tuesday and Wednesday nights from 7 to 10 p.m. and Sunday afternoons from 2 to 5. These meetings are held at the Grassroots House, which is located at 2022 Blake Street in Berkeley. You can't volunteer, but you have books you want to donate. Bring your donations by Moe's Bookstore on Telegraph Avenue in Berkeley, or drop them off at Bound Together Books in San Francisco. For Full Circle, this is Jin Lei.
day will be sunny when I lay my Buddha down.
This is Full Circle here on KPFA 94.1 FM. We are your hosts, Johannes Dra
and Roddy Kill.
We just played a song called When I Lay My Burden Down from the Angola Prison Spiritual CD. These spirituals were recorded in the late 50s at the Louisiana State Prison in Angola, Louisiana. The voices of these prisoners continue to resonate through the years, reaching us even today. East Bay tenor saxophonist Howard Wiley just released an album called The Angola Project based on these very spirituals. Recently, Tara Purdy had a chance to catch up with Howard and talk to him about his work. Let's hear what he had to say.
A little bit about your musical career.
Sure. I started when I was 11 years old playing the saxophone. It's a really funny story. I remember we were going to the cleaners, my parents and I, and my dad told me I was watching too much television and I had to pick an instrument. He said I could either play piano again, which I did when I was younger, saxophone or drums. And I knew my grandfather had played with the great Count Basie, was a tenor saxophonist, so I started playing saxophone. And I just really took a liking to it after I heard Charlie Parker. Once I heard Yardbird, it was all over. And that just changed the scope of my life at that point and really started focusing on music. And I released my first CD when I was 15. I was called Businessman. And I got the opportunity to play with a lot of great musicians, a lot of different types of musicians. When I was in high school, I was a member of this thing called the Grammy Band, and I got to play with Arturo Sandoval and Clark Terry and Kenny Loggins and Ed Maya, Carlos Santana, a whole host of people. Very eclectic group of musicians I got a chance to perform with and just hang out and play. And locally, I played with Marcus Shelby and the great dynamic Miss Faye Carroll, who's on the CD. And recently, I started performing with David Murray, and David Murray is on the new album as well. So it's just been a wonderful ride and adventure and swing, and hopefully I'm continuing the tradition that the Grace Lake Duke and Train laid down for us.
The Chronicle said that what really gives you your status among musicians in New York and San Francisco is not so much harmony as it is texture. What exactly does that mean?
Well, the way I interpret it is a lot of the music that affects me the most is what I call vibe music. It's something that you can just put on, and it's like a soundtrack to life. When you put on Ornette Coleman's The Shape of Jazz to Come and Lonely Woman comes on, it has that soundtrack to life. When you put on John Coltrane's Africa Brass, it has that soundtrack to life. When you put on Donny Hathaway, you know, Donny Hathaway record Everything is Everything, it has that soundtrack to life. You can just sit back and understand so much about life and what's going on, and I try to represent that in my music. This is something I say a lot, having transcended spirituality in my music, like, you know, Mahalia Jackson and Coltrane and Duke Ellington. They had an intangible something, you know, like I talked to Faye Carroll when she said she first started listening to Billie Holiday. She really didn't understand it, but she felt it. The same thing happened with me when I was listening to Ornette Coleman. So I try to capture that transcendent spirituality, that in between the notes, what Miles Davis said, that intangible something that grabs the listener, that grabbed me in the playing music.
So you just released your new CD, The Angola Project. What was your inspiration?
My partner on this project is an Angola scholar and a master's candidate in ethnomusicology at the University of Washington. He was trying to get me to listen to the CD from Arhuli Records, Prison Spirituals for the Longest. He was like, man, this is some extraordinarily profound music, and you need to check it out. But at first mention, I was like, prison spirituals, prison music, I can't really see myself getting into that. But I went to visit him, and he cornered me and put on the music, and it was some of the most profound, touching music I'd ever come across. And then I just started trying to listen to as much of it as I could. I heard all these techniques that aren't too common in mainstream Western music, like, you know, playing out of time, not like rubato, which is common in classical music, but what the soloist is playing or singing dictates how fast or slow the song goes at any given part. And they employ a lot of these techniques, and these musicians were trained in like the folk tradition. And so it's like straight from the soul, and it's touching and powerful. But the nail in the coffin is this cat went down to Angola State Penitentiary, and I went and documented some stories and some music. Actually, the first track on the CD, 12 Gates to the City, is the first song that I heard that he recorded from Angola right before Katrina. this music is so powerful, what they're doing is like a time capsule, because what is happening there isn't happening in the outside world. The fact that Angola State Penitentiary is a plantation prison, and that they have major businesses, you know, in agriculture, and they have a rodeo that grosses over $1.something million a year, and the fact that these cats go and work a plantation, the fact that it's a man on a horse holding a rifle, keeping these guys in line, all that was just so profound to me, I had to do something with it. But the music is what grabbed me.
Do you have any personal connection with the subject of incarceration?
No, I don't have any personal connection. No, I don't have anyone in my family who's been incarcerated. But I do have friends, and I do see what it's doing to our society and our culture, and how it's affecting the youngsters. These young kids are growing up with these ideals of what it's like to be incarcerated, and the glorification of violence and incarceration is something that we really need to work on, really need to change in our society's perception that we're feeding our children. And just where our society is going, where we're using incarceration as a way to deal with poverty.
Well, on that note, I want to thank you so much for joining us tonight. And before you leave, would you tell us a little bit about the next song we're about to hear?
This song is the first piece I composed for the Angola Project. I was fortunate enough to be commissioned by Intersection for the Arts to write this composition. It's called The Conversation. It's two historians who went down the Angola prison in the late 50s. One guy is famous, Alan Lomax, and the other guy is Harry Ulster. And this particular piece is inspired by an interview by Alan Lomax with this prisoner named Bama. And Bama is just what I was talking about. He was a total victim of his circumstances, being poor, being black, being born in poverty, and being uneducated. And he was telling about how he became incarcerated and his dealings with the system. And he was making light of the situation, you know, to laugh and keep from crying. And Lomax was laughing at him and not with him. And it was one of the saddest conversations I heard, because from an outsider looking in, I just totally see how this cat is just a victim of circumstances out of his control and just a victim of being born in poverty. And this composition is called The Conversation, and it's my musical representation of that.
Well, thank you so much.
Well, thank you for having me. Thank you.
That was Conversations by Howard Wiley. Welcome back to Full Circle. Next, Ursula Nellejoy presents our ongoing series, Hi Mom. Mary Jane has taught from preschool through graduate school. She has been advocating change in the educational system throughout her career. This week, Mary Jane describes her beliefs about the educational system and how it directs many young people towards incarceration.
Hi, Mom.
Hi, honey. I was just looking at this new CD by Wynton Marsalis. It's called From the Plantation to the Penitentiary. Because he realizes what happened, that half of the good guys are drained off into prisons. Half of the high school students drop out.
Half?
Half. Because they're labeled at an early age. You know, when you were in kindergarten, you knew by noon who were the good kids, who were the bad kids. We're trying to teach right-brain kids in a left-brain way. It's not working. The brain scientists have known this for 40 years. And once they're in prison, they have to give up their body organs to get out early. Here's from yesterday's paper. Inmates in South Carolina could soon find that a kidney is worth 180 days.
What? That's crazy.
Yes, if you give up your kidney, you get out earlier.
Oh, God.
That's terrible.
Well, Mom, what are we going to do?
Well, close the schools.
Well, how's that going to help?
Well, there's so many things to learn, so many ways. Who's got a future in reading?
Oh, Momsy, I got to go.
Well, okay, bye.
Bye, Mom.
Touching the hearts for all to feel.
That brings us to the end of tonight's show. Tune in next week to Full Circle, the same time, Friday at 7, and the same station, KPFA 94.1 FM. We'll be cooking up a show on food and culture. You can check out our archive shows on www.kpfa.org.
Special thanks to our production and technical interns, Donna Bellarado, Shonda Field, Ricky Gates, Rose Katachi, Ursula Nellajoy, and Tara Purdy. Our executive producers are Ranjita Giesler and Miss M. Our senior producer is Jin Lay. Our technical director is Antonio Ortiz. Our lead segment editor is Idris Hassan. And our advisor is Amelia Gonzalez.
If you have any questions or topics for future shows, give us a call at 510-848-6767, extension 627, or send us an email to fullcircle@kpfa.org. We start our Purdy holding down the controls. We have been your hosts, Rod Akil and Johannes Graf. Thanks for joining us tonight on Full Circle. Stay tuned for La Onda Bajita.
KPFA is looking for listeners who would like to work on KPFA's Program Council. The Program Council assists KPFA.